Previously on Engineering Jigsaw, we've talked about web interfaces and how technologies such as representational state transfer, or REST for short, allow devices to connect to the internet, to web servers, and collect information from them. Also, in our last episode, we talked about why software-defined vehicles need a new kind of diagnostics, service-oriented vehicle diagnostics, or SOVD for short. And we also talked about some of the most important things that SOVD provides in its characteristics. How does SOVD actually work, though? Let's go find out. Hi everybody, I'm Ian Cunningham from Vets GB. Welcome to this foundation level episode of Engineering the Jigsaw. Foundation episode number 23, how does SOVD work? Well, as a recap, in F22 we talked about service-oriented access to a vehicle and how with a software-defined vehicle, our access would typically be via a vehicle API, which would be service-oriented. So this is our access point if we want to do diagnostics with the technology such as SOVD. Now, if we're accessing a vehicle with SOVD, then SOVD is based on a REST API using the Hypertext Transfer Protocol, or HTTP for short. What does this mean? Well, essentially, if we have a vehicle which implements SOVD, we can think of it as a web server. So it's analogous. So we can connect web clients, such as browsers, to that server and retrieve information for it. Of course, if we're able to treat vehicles like web servers, we need this access to be secure. And SOVD is typically secured using Open Authentication 2.0, or OAuth 2.0 as it's known. This is a well-known technology on internet websites. You probably use it every day without realizing it, but it's a very, very commonly used standard for security when we want to log into to systems. And as we said, we're treating the vehicle as a web server. So what we have inside the vehicle is a function that operates as a web server, provides that REST API. And this is the SOVD server. So we've got a function that provides this REST API for us. And of course, the SOVD server, We need to be able to kind of, in a diagnostic context, be able to access the content of the vehicle in an easy way. And the SOVD server presents a structured API to clients. So the REST API is structured. What does that mean? Well, we have firstly a web address that will get us to the web server in question for a particular vehicle, the SOVD server, I should say, for a particular vehicle. And then within this, we have a structure of things we can talk to. So within an SOVD vehicle, we can think about accessing different kinds of thing. So in technical terms, these are entity types. And we have the ability to define areas. We have the ability to define components. We have the ability to define apps and also the ability to define functions as entity types. And all of those entity types are optional. So we really have to be able to perform a discovery process when we connect to a vehicle equipped with an SOVD server to understand what entity types are available. And also, they can exist independently. So that means we don't have to have linking, but we can also have linking. So, for example, if we think about areas can have sub-areas. So area 51 can be subdivided. areas also have the ability to have related components. So Area 51 may have a spaceship related to it. Components can have subcomponents. So a spaceship has a ray gun. And components can have related apps. So here is our death ray app, which we can use to fire the ray gun. Ow! Not very nice. So each entity we need to be able to identify. So we talked about Area 51. This is a name for an area. We talked about the spaceship. We talked about the ray gun. We talked about the ray gun app. So they all have some kind of identity that lets us identify which entity we want to work with in the API. Stepping further into the API, then we can think that each entity can present different types of resources that we can retrieve or interact with. So, yeah, the spaceship, there are many different things we might want to get access to inside the spaceship, for example. And we also, in addition to being able to, yeah, the standard has different kinds of resource types. Probably the easiest ones to grasp, especially if you understand UDS already, which we've talked about previously, or OBD, the most easily grasped things are data, so analogous to read data by identifier or parameter IDs, faults, obviously DTCs directly correlate here, and modes. So we have modes that we can activate. We can also have operations, for example, that we can interact with. So there are many different types of resource defined in the standard. This is just a very small set of them. And we, of course, need to have identities for these individual resources as well. So we need to have names for them. So let's kind of try and put this into some kind of example. So if we think about an example SOVD request, we might want to, among the components of a vehicle, talk to the ADAS computer, and from that ADAS computer, access the data that corresponds to the CPU load of the ADAS computer. So that is an example of how an SOVD request could be structured. Of course, your SOVD server may present things slightly differently. Certainly the names could be different, but that's an example. So what would a response then look like? Well, a response, as we said, it is a REST API response, and it's structured as JSON, JavaScript Object Notation. So we get the ID, CPU load, repeated, and then we get the data. We were asking for data, the CPU load, and now, so we can now see the core loads of each core of the CPU. And these are being presented to me in immediately usable numbers. I don't have to convert from hexadecimal numbers to work out what the percentage of CPU loading is. It tells me directly in the response. I don't need to do further processing of this data to already have a usable insight into the data that I'm interested in within the vehicle. So this is a big part of SOVD, is that we get human readable, pre-converted, so engineering values that we can read a quantity and immediately know what that quantity is. So how do we understand what entities are actually in a vehicle with an SOVD server? So as each client connects to a vehicle, the SOVD server scans for entities within the vehicle. And this is really important. We talked previously about how the software environment in a software-defined vehicle is continually able to change. So we need to know when a client connects what the software environment is, so we can detect what the entities are. So we have this kind of scanning that happens. And each SOVD capable entity will register itself with the SOVD server at this point in time. So an SOVD app, for example, or a component would present itself and register. And there is a special entity as classic diagnostic adapter that presents UDS ECU entities. So we have components that correspond to each ECU in the vehicle from the classic diagnostic adapter. So this is how we can use SOVD to also access UDS. Really important. And there's a really special kind of resource that we can make use of. There's also something called capability description. Now, if we want to understand what's available via SOVD, we can ask a particular entity or resource for its documentation. So what can it do for us? What capability does it give us? So it's documentation. This is described with a special request where we have docs as part of the path. So how would our request look like? If we wanted to understand what the ADAS computer supports, our request would be then to the ADAS computer for the docs. And we would get back then a response structured in a format called Open API, again, another web standard that describes the SOVD capability of that entity that we've queried. So this is really important. It means that we can ask a vehicle, when we connect to a vehicle, we can find out what's in there, and then we can ask each thing what it's able to do. So a software update no longer means our diagnostic data is out of date, because every software update would change the responses as well. As a summary, service-oriented vehicle diagnostics does a load of really, really cool stuff. It's based on existing web technologies and best practices. So, for example, we use REST APIs, we use JSON to transfer data with human readable values, there's Open Authentication 2.0 to make it secure. We have a structured self-describing API on top of this using that Open API technology. We have the ability to access entity resources, and the SOVD server scans for entities when a client connects to make sure that it's presenting the latest set of capability to us. And we also, most importantly of all possibly, allow legacy diagnostics via a classic diagnostic adapter that performs a translation from SOVD to UDS and takes those UDS responses, converts them back to SOVD for us to make use of. That's everything we've got time for in this episode. Please make sure to visit our website for details of the support of SOVD across vectors, tools, and embedded software. And if you really want to get into the details of how SOVD works, make sure to keep an eye out for our special SOVD training available via the Vector Academy. That's everything we've got time for. I'll speak to you again after the music. Bye. Really hope you've enjoyed this episode of Engineering the Jigsaw. Make sure if you give it a thumbs up in YouTube. If you have questions or ideas, then give us a comment down below the video. If you don't want to do it in public, if you want to keep it private, then drop us an email to our special email address, engineering.jigsaw@vector.com. You can find a link to our webpage with those contact details on in the description for this video. Make sure that you subscribe to get notified as we release new episodes and as Vector publishes its excellent and informative videos on its YouTube channel. Make sure to check out our playlists. We have our foundation episodes playlist and also intermediate level playlist as well for you to binge and catch up with. We'll catch you for another episode soon. Goodbye.